over an extraction so he could speak to this group. You all have his bio information in your package. He's a professor of law at St. John's University. So I think you should give him a great welcome and enjoy the lecture.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon to each of you. It's really great to be here. I had the wonderful opportunity of speaking to a Chautauqua audience this summer. And as a teacher who has a captive audience on a regular basis, and I also do a fair amount of speaking elsewhere, a Chautauqua crowd is particularly special. And I'm really pleased to be back here talking to all of you. I'm very grateful to Judy and to the Elder Hostel program. Also to the folks in Jamestown who have been building a Robert H. Jackson Center. Greg Peterson, who's the president and the board members there, together with Chautauqua, sponsored a wonderful series of events this week that brought former Nuremberg prosecutors to this region because their boss, Justice Robert H. Jackson, the chief American prosecutor of Nuremberg, was a son of Jamestown. That's where he got his start in legal practice, where he lived for decades. And Jackson and the work they did with Jackson and Nuremberg meant so much to these gentlemen that they came like that when they heard about the Jackson Center and the efforts to develop a center that will host programs and a research facility to continue the memory, to commemorate the achievements of Justice Jackson. And this here today, my opportunity to speak with you, is really the final piece of that series of events that Chautauqua and the Jackson Center together have brought this week. Now, here's how I view what we've been doing this week. We've been bringing Nuremberg back to Chautauqua County. And you may wonder, obviously, since you know where Nuremberg is, why I say back. Let me give you a couple of historical moments to think about it. I think you'll see the web of ties. The first one is actually in 1901 in Buffalo. The Pan American Exhibition was in Buffalo in remembered by us because it's where President McKinley was assassinated by an anarchist, and that's what made Theodore Roosevelt president and obviously hugely affected the path of history for the rest of the 20th century. But one of the features of that exhibition was a very sizable construction financed by the German-American community in Buffalo that was a replica reconstruction of the old city of Nuremberg, 1901. Why did they do this? Because Nuremberg, Germany, was and is, as a matter of history and heritage, a seat of great beauty, great architecture. This is a 14th century walled city, the home of music, the home of literature, poetry, and it's largely been rebuilt to jump to the present time, but obviously skipping through the immediate destruction. But that was a sort of early appearance and appreciation for the physical locale of Nuremberg on the part of the pioneers and community in Buffalo that brought this great exhibition to this region. Now jump ahead to 1945. The war has ended. The European continent is devastated. Nuremberg is largely obliterated. But what it does have is a semi-intact courthouse, the Palace of Justice, and a fully intact attached prison complex. And so, and into the American sector of control in the post-surrender occupied Germany. And so it is selected as the site for what we now remember as the Nuremberg trials, the prosecution of the principal Nazi war criminals. It also had a great symbolic value, and these I'm sure were part of the decision that led to the selection of the site, of being the home of the virulently anti-Semitic Nuremberg laws, the site of Hitler's Nuremberg rallies in the Stadt, and other important sort of Third Reich connections. Robert Jackson, at that point, 1945, a justice of the United States Supreme Court, is assigned by President Henry to go and put together the plan to pick the site and to be the chief American prosecutor at what becomes the International Military Tribunal in Nuremberg. In other words, Chautauqua County, this region, Nuremberg, again, directly linked, and we're commemorating this week in 1945. Jump ahead two more years, July 4th, 1947. The prosecuting, the international thing, is Jackson's work, is done in Nuremberg, and he is back on the Supreme Court in 46. The court, as you know, takes a summer recess, and so after being fully occupied with his speak about and reflect on his experiences as Chief American Prosecutor is that next summer, the summer of 1947. Where does he do it? In the amphitheater at Chautauqua Institution to a crowd of about 7,000 people, where he delivers the 4th of July 10 a.m. address, beginning to explain what was done, what it meant for accountability following World War II and for the future of law. And since the Cold War had broken out, as it's already described, by July 1947, Jackson tried to deliver something of hopeful message that the nations had been able at Nuremberg to do something cooperative. It was sort of the last gasp of the alliance, perhaps, but that he, in his heart, had invented Nuremberg and working with French, Russian, and Soviet prosecutors to accomplish that prosecution effort, didn't believe the Third World War was inevitable. And that was the hopeful message that he brought to the Chautauqua audience on July 4, 1947. Now, the fourth moment was this past week. The gentleman who came, participated in a conversation yesterday morning at the Jackson Center. Three principal prosecutors, two who were podium prosecutors at the Jackson trial, the trial of 21 principal Nazi defendants led by Hermann Göring, Albert Speer, Rudolf Hess, Joachim von Ribbentrop, you know the cast of characters. Two of the younger then, senior now, but extremely vital attorneys came with another of their staff colleagues and had really quite an extraordinary discussion on how it had worked, what their piece of the work had been, what they thought about it at the time, what they thought and remembered of Justice Jackson, and what they believe it means for us today, 55 years later. I hope a few of you were able to be there. I know the rest of you were here enjoying some excellent alternative programming. But the good news is that that discussion was taped and recorded. And I think there's quite a good likelihood it will be on C-SPAN relatively soon. And in future years, all that material is sort of in the can and will be part of the display and the continuing education at the Jackson Center in Jamestown. Last night, to cap off that day, there was a dinner in the Athenaeum, and some of you may have been stumbling over us as we were in the left dining room as you look out the front door. And following the meal, Whitney Harris, one of the prosecutors, gave an address that really was his valedictory on Nuremberg. I wouldn't even presume to repeat his words because he is a figure of such stature and eloquence and achievement that it would be inappropriate piggyback. But those remarks, he wrote in advance. There's a beautiful transcript, and I think those will be published relatively soon, too. It choked him up, and I assure you it choked me up to hear him talk about what he had been a part of 55 years ago. Now, those are just the connections. Let me step back and talk to you about Jackson and Jackson's path that led him to Nuremberg. Bob, if I can presume to call him that, because that's what he has to be called for his whole life, Bob Jackson, was born in a little town called Spring Creek, just over the Pennsylvania state line, south of here. In a family farmhouse in 1892. It wasn't a poor family, but it wasn't a wealthy family. It was a hard-working, comfortable family, descendant of early immigrant settlers who had gone to the West to make a stand and build a homestanding farm in the West, then it was Pennsylvania. Jackson, born in 1892, moves with his family up across the New York state line and grows up in the little town of Frewsburg, south of Jamestown, and that's where he was schooled and graduated from the Frewsburg High School. A good, solid, traditional, early 20th century education, but you know, I assure you, nothing fancy was part of his educational background. He then comes to the big city, which is Jamestown, and spends a postgraduate year from 1910 to 1911 at the Jamestown High School. Maybe it was common, although I haven't found many other traces of it. He may have been its only graduate student in its history. But at the Jamestown High School, as an 18-year-old, he had a program of courses that he took, and a couple of key mentors, the principal who really exposed him to political theory and economics, and a literature teacher who took him through Shakespearean plays and got him involved in the Lyceum, the dating organization, and helped him to, I think, develop his early skills as an orator. time. I focus on that here because that's the end of his general higher education. He never went to college. What he did instead, following that year, was begin to work as an apprentice in a law office for a gentleman who was a cousin on his mother's side, 20 years Jackson Sr., and began to what we call read the law. He was getting to follow this fellow around and draft various papers. It was a general small town litigation and transactional practice that he was exposed to. To augment his learning, he went to Albany Law School for a year after a year of practicing with a lawyer. And in his 9 months, 1911, 12, at Albany Law School, he reads, studies 2 years worth of course material. And also, he admits, not quite fully, but enough for you to get the idea, that he skipped a lot of classes, and he hung out at the state legislature and at the state courthouse watching the New York Court of Appeals in session. Which gives you a sense of the thirst, the intellectual energy, and I think the aspirations of this young man up off the farm originally in Warren Township, Pennsylvania. Following his year at Albany, he's still only 20 years old. He's kind of gotten what he thinks there is to get out of law school. He's too young for them to give him a diploma. So he comes back to Jamestown and resumes reading the law and working as an apprentice with a local lawyer. And when he turns 21 in February of 1913, he takes the year of bar exam, he had to be 21, and of course passes and becomes a lawyer. And then for the following 20 years, he embarks on a path of incredible private practice legal achievement in this half of the state. I'll spare you the details, but just to give you a flavor. He starts out representing people whose cows have died and thinks that somebody, you know, put sewage in the stream and killed their cow, and represented those plaintiffs in those kind of lawsuits. Or he represented some strikers who've been arrested for vandalizing the streetcar company by cutting down the poles as part of their labor activity. You know, kind of a scruffy outside of law practice, and he wins, and he wins, and he wins. The cow case, cow botulism, was a suit against the Jamestown municipality for contaminated water supply. He cleans their flock twice on behalf of the cows, the cow owner. And that's enough for the Jamestown Corporation Council to hire Jackson to do the city's work from then on. And his practice quickly moves forward, and before many years have passed, he represents still friends and neighbors and individuals in many contexts, but also the bank and the utility and the streetcar company and the independent telephone company, et cetera, et cetera. And he becomes a force in organized bar activities in Western New York, and he's very active in Democratic politics, first at the very local level, then at the regional level, then at the state level. Never running for office other than elected party representative to state conventions, but a rising star on that front too. And one of the things that he reconnects to is a young politician who he had observed when he was skipping those classes back at Albany Law School, that back then had been the first term state senator Franklin Roosevelt from Dutchess County. By this time, it's Assistant Secretary of the Navy under President Wilson, Franklin Roosevelt, who's a friend in Washington. And so when Jackson's making some trips down there to lobby for his guy to get appointed postmaster in the county and things like that, Frank Roosevelt is a friendly office, and it's a place to check in. That friendship and that relationship is the door to many, many bigger things. Jackson conquers the law in Western New York, and by the early 1930s, is very prosperous, very active, and still very young. Roosevelt becomes president. He immediately tries to get Jackson to come to Washington to join the New Deal. And Jackson's quite reluctant, in part because of his love for this area, in part because he had young children, and I think he didn't want to take the first job he was offering as part of it, too. But after about a year and a half, the right job offer, the call comes, and Jackson goes and joins the New Deal. And in a 7-year run, follow this resume. His first job is the Assistant General Counsel in the Bureau of Revenue, the Treasury Department, what today we know as the Internal Revenue Service. 2 years there, doing tax law and supervising the staff of 200, but really, since he hated administrative work, handling a lot of big cases himself, is followed by transferred to the Justice Department, where he's first the Assistant Attorney General in charge of the Tax Division. Then a year later, he's the Assistant Attorney General in charge of the Antitrust Division. Then a year later, he becomes Solicitor General of the United States, at that point the new position in the Department of Justice, and the executive branch representative and advocate who goes to the Supreme Court to defend the constitutionality of the federal legislation. Following those 2 years as Solicitor General, he becomes Attorney General of the United States. And after a year and a half in that position, he's appointed to be an Associate Justice of the United States Supreme Court. That's a resume. That's a 7-year rocket shot. And he's still a young man. This is 1941. He's 49 years old when he joins the United States Supreme Court. Now we'll start taking the sharp turn into the experience that becomes Nuremberg. On the morning of Monday, December 8, 1941, a day after the day that it would end to be, Justice Jackson, in his first term on the Supreme Court bench, is with his colleagues hearing oral argument concerning this momentous issue. Are corporate payments of country club dues on behalf of executive officers of the corporation taxable as a personal income event for the operator and officer of the corporation? Bob Jackson thinks, you know, good God, our country's been attacked, a world war is beginning, and I'm here on the deductibility of country club greens fees, which I think gives you a sense of his passion and his sense of purpose. He voices this in the conference among the justices, and so one of the little ironies is that Chief Justice Stone assigned Jackson to write the opinion in that case, which you can look up. But it's a nice, eloquent, and utterly insignificant tax decision that the court rendered in early 1942. During the early war years, Jackson was no longer in the executive branch. He had been, as Attorney General, really part of the pre-war and early war cabinet, giving legal advice to the president about things like exchanging overage American destroyers to the British in return for Caribbean bases, the early other parts of land lease, the beginning of the selective service and conscription in 1940. Roosevelt wanted him on the Supreme Court because he ultimately intended to make him Chief Justice. But Jackson certainly felt that he was performing less service for his country on the court than he had been as Attorney General, and then he wanted to in his heart. And during the early war years, this is a topic that he and Roosevelt discussed in their ongoing private relationship. They go fishing together, they play cards together, and so forth. And Jackson regularly said to Roosevelt, look, Mr. President, should there be anything you wish me to do, I would gladly leave the Supreme Court and fill in the blank. And Roosevelt said, I want to leave you there for now. I think he probably said it right. I will be making you Chief Justice before very long. And he said, Jackson reports later in some interviews, I have something in mind for you after the war. Franklin Roosevelt didn't see it in the war. But there was something for Robert Jackson after the war. By early 1945, it's clear that the Nazis will be defeated, the right will be crushed, and one issue is then what to do with these former government officials who attempted to conquer the world. The evidence, there's a vast history on the evidence and when different pieces of what became known in what circles, but the evidence is developing and mounting of horrible conduct of various types by 43, 44, 45. And so this discussion about what to do is a discussion about war crimes, at least at the general level. And the debate is occurring even up at the level of the big three, Roosevelt, Stalin, Churchill, at Tehran, at Moscow, at Yalta. And the general argument, forcefully made by Stalin, agreed to by Churchill, and in a kind of joking way, agreed to by FDR, is let's just use executive action. Let's be prudent. Executive action between lining people up against the wall and you shoot them. And Stalin said, let's just, you know, the top 50,000 or so of the Nazis should be addressed through executive action. And Churchill said, I'll agree to that. And Roosevelt joked, well, you know, maybe only 49-5. But there were voices beneath Roosevelt in the government fully urging that act. Cordell Hull, the Secretary of State, Henry Morgenthau, the Secretary of Treasury, not only favored executive action with regard to individuals, he favored what actually is sort of a mirror of the Hitler scorched earth plan to obliterate the remaining industrial capacity of Germany and leave it as an agrarian pastoral setting. In other words, solve the problem and not worry about it in the future by reducing them to starvation, farming, peasantry. A few voices began to argue for an alternative approach. One was Secretary of War, Henry Simpson, and one was Supreme Court Justice Robert Jackson. The argument that they begin to voice is an argument for a real trial of the responsible individuals who perpetrated these crimes. The debate then sort of said, well, yeah, that would look good. Let's have quick trials and then shoot them. And you chuckle because you see the problem. Roosevelt died on Thursday, April 12, 1945, at Warm Springs. Jackson had a long scheduled commitment to give a speech the next evening, Friday, April 13, before the American Society of International Law. And at that moment, this sort of mock trial, or quickie trial idea was what was kind of in the air, and Jackson went to the ASIL podium and gave a forceful speech against it and said, no. You know, if what you're doing is a show trial, and you know the end of the process is already scripted, that's not a trial. You shouldn't debase the name of law and the rituals of trial and the ethic of due process by applying it to this show. Just use executive action, if you will, or have a real trial. As Jackson's making that speech in Washington, a speech during which he gets quite noticeably choked up, he refers to Roosevelt, who died the previous evening. And it was echoed for me in a very poignant way last night, and Whitney Harris got quite choked up while referring to his old boss, Robert Jackson. Roosevelt's team is in Britain trying to move the British to something other than the executive action position. That team's headed by Judge Sam Rosenman, who was Roosevelt's key speechwriter and emissary. And when Roosevelt dies, Rosenman is in London. He comes back, and it's one of the things Harry Truman knew nothing about, like the Manhattan Project also. Rosenman explains to Truman what they're in the midst of doing. They're trying to get away from the firing squad model and move towards some kind of trial model. And more or less what happened, what had to happen, although it's not documented, in a way I've been able to find yet, is a conversation between Rosenman and Truman, where Rosenman, who was a judge, a trial judge in New York, one of his many functions, said, you know, not a firing squad, a trial, a real trial. And Truman, after sort of thinking about it, said, well, okay, who can make this happen? And Rosenman had to say, clearly did say, Bob Jackson, someone who the country knew as this meteoric talent, this incredible writer, this figure in American law, somebody who had been both a great trial level and appellate level lawyer. Somebody who was from the top of the American legal profession, the Supreme Court, and Truman agrees with the plan, and he appoints Jackson to go in May of 1945 to make this happen. Now, Jackson's assignment, he unrealistically thought could be performed during the summer recess of the court, so he could be back by the first Monday in October. In fact, it took him a full year. What they packed into that year, or what they accomplished, is quite amazing as you look back at it. Jackson first goes to London and sits down with representatives of Britain, France, and the Soviet Union, four disparate legal systems, and hammers out an agreement on how they will do a joint trial, merging and modifying the legal systems to a common charter and a common procedure, largely following ours. The French struggle to trial kept trying to learn how to cross-examine, but never got it, for instance. And the Russians kept wanting to return verdicts from the prosecutor's podium. The prosecutor would try and stand up and say, you know, and so, guilty. You're supposed to prove guilty. We're the tribunal. We get to say guilty or not guilty. So, I mean, there were some vast cultural divides, but Jackson and London hammers out an agreement on how it will be structured. He did hold a lot of the cards because most of the principal surviving Nazis had been captured by the U.S. Army. Were in American sectors. So, you know, if nations couldn't do it together, and they were going to build their own way, we had the people to take and handle and try on our own. And that obviously helped Jackson bring along the other nations to the agreement. But over the summer of 45, they hammer out the agreement, and they define in their charter not only the procedure, but the crimes that this proceeding can prosecute and bring to the tribunal. What they define is four crimes. I'll work my way up. Conspiracy, which is a general crime of agreement, but it has to be connected to a criminal objective, is one of the things. The other three crimes are criminal objectives that one could have a conspiracy to do. One is to commit war crimes. Those are crimes by one belligerent against the opposing party. They're sort of soldier-to-soldier crimes. They involve mistreatment of prisoners of war, torture of military prisoners, those kinds of things. Second crime, crimes against humanity. Those are crimes by a belligerent against the civilian population, internal or external. Third crime that they define is the crime of aggressive war. That war itself, the launching, the initiation, the willful commencement of war, was the crime from which all other crimes flowed. And Jackson, from the start through the finish, for the rest of his life, saw that as the point of Nuremberg. And it's what he hammers out and codifies for the first time in that London agreement in a way that has been the precedent of great importance for international law. They then select 22 Nazis to be charged with these crimes. What they did was try to find the senior representative of each essential sector in what had been the Third Reich and perpetrated the conduct of World War II, the military, the Navy, the Army, etc., propaganda, the economy, industrialists, bankers, etc., the Air Force, the State Security, the Gestapo, the intelligence agencies, etc., etc. They're personified by the gentleman I referred to earlier in their co-defendants. As Deputy Fuhrer and former head of the Luftwaffe, Albert Speer as the Minister of Armaments, Rudolf Hess as the previous Deputy Fuhrer, Helmut Schacht as the President of the Reichsbank, etc., etc. Those 22 people are indicted and brought to the location that was picked for the trial in Nuremberg, Germany. The trial begins in November 1945 with what everyone remembers as the finest courtroom speech probably in the history of the English language. If I don't presume to repeat Whitney Harris's words, I certainly don't presume to repeat Robert Jackson's words very much, but let me give you one or two sentences, which are part of how he opened, and I think it gives you a sense of his power in his words. He said that four great nations, stung with the injuries of war and flushed with the power of victory, this tribunal and assuming the burdens of proving their guilt is the greatest tribute that power has ever paid to reason. Anyone not from there? In very well. Have an opportunity, it's a speech to read. Following the opening, they had divvied up among the four nations the prosecution responsibility. The American piece was first. Jackson, as the chief American prosecutor, was actively involved in their part to perpetrate war crimes, to perpetrate crimes against humanity, and thus really it was the piece of the case that was the whole case. And what Jackson did as a tactical decision was decided to present the case through documents. Documents which had been rigorously, systematically, bureaucratically assembled throughout the Reich, because this was a thousand-year Reich they were building as they conquered Europe. Documenting their achievements was part of the history they were building, and so it was all there in triplicate. Some in buildings, some buried in fields, some in caves, some in diaries, but there was remorseless documentation. Documents are boring. Even horrific documents are boring, and they're read one after another after another after another. Jackson heard that argument among his staff and decided on the pain of boredom and the price of sort of losing the press excitement. Not to build a case on witnesses, people who cut deals, people who were offering memories whose credibility could be questioned, who might be trading somebody no worse than themselves in return for their own skin. Instead, Jackson said, go on the documents. They're pre-existing, their credibility is unassailable, they will stand as a historical record. And so he took a fair amount of heat for boring proof. They're arguing for an independent tribunal. And so the defendants, in many cases, took the stand, and Jackson handled the cross-examination of a number of them. I think he sort of stepped up to the responsibilities of his title, and not as a matter of ego, but as a matter of doing the hard work. He personally cross-examined Herman Burger. He personally cross-examined Omar Schacht. He personally cross-examined Albert Speer. It's interesting to study that part of the trial, because when you're in trial, you get a combat momentum and mentality. I once was a prosecutor, and I know it from a pedestrian context in which I was a prosecutor. I'm sure it's all the more true in something like Nuremberg. You're in there, and you're sort of on the playing field, you're battling, you're fighting. Jackson, in those cross-examinations, deserves some criticism. Different criticism, some criticism. With Goering, I think he was outflanked on some tactics. Allowed Goering to speechify, and only toward the end of the examination, through the documents again, sort of got the admissions and the resignation from Goering that proved the culpability, but he lost the show with Goering. And I think it's because he was trying too hard for a knockout punch in that examination. With Schacht, who had not even been in Germany during the war, he ceased to be Reichsminister in the late 1930s. Jackson is dealing with a haughty witness who refused to sort of admit that he belonged in the room. He turned his back on his co-defendants as if to say, I ain't got nothing to do with these guys. You know, they got rid of me. What I was part of running the Reichsbank was just economic development in the late 1930s. You, sir, asking me questions is an insult to orderly process. And besides, I'm an American. I have an American parent, and my middle name, for God's sake, is Horace Greeley. And I think Jackson, in that examination, was a bit cowed by the force of what Schacht was arguing. But maybe, in a sense, what Jackson was establishing by losing that battle of the wills with Schacht, and ultimately seeing Schacht acquitted, was proving what a real trial this was. They weren't all acquitted. They weren't all acquitted. Schacht and two others, in the end, were acquitted because a real trial was not. Third examination, referring to Albert Speer, was somebody who was repentant, who couldn't quite explain why he had become a Nazi from being quite a cultivated man and an architect, sort of a protege and a friend of the Fuhrer, but did not argue his culpability. And I think in that case, the historical question is, did Jackson develop too great an affinity with a guy who was willing to repent, admit responsibility, and frankly was attractive in many ways? That was one of the topics that our guest, Henry King, who worked closely examining Speer, referred to in his remarks over the past couple of days. So that's just a glimpse of the Jackson examinations. The trial ends in the summer of 1946, and Jackson gives a closing that is up there with his opening of the previous November, just a majestic speech. It ends with lines from Richard III, and Jackson then plays off of them and says, the Queen says, but he is dead. And Jackson says, and they are dead. And for this tribunal not to return convictions would be to say there are no dead. There was no war. There is no crime. And the record he made obviously persuaded the tribunal that there were dead. There had been war. War is a crime. And so 11 men were given, 12 men were given death sentences. Six others were convicted and given prison sentences ranging from 5 years to life in Spain. And three were acquitted. And in October, Herman Goering committed suicide. The 11 others who received death sentences were hung. And the work of Nuremberg in terms of trying these people, providing a real trial, was completed. And Robert Jackson was back in the bench of the Supreme Court Justice. But that's only the trial, that's the achievement of the alternative to the executive action. A real proceeding, a real burden of proof carried by both prosecutors in the fair proceeding. What they left is something much bigger. And that's what these gentlemen were speaking about this week. They left a model for the international community to live up to. You'll probably ask about that as we have some questions and further discussion, so I won't go into it, but it is nations into the community of general agreement. But the foundation for Jackson is the principle that aggressive war is a crime, that crossing the border, attacking a neighbor, launching military activity can never be justified. And I think that is a topic of general agreement, and that is something that was inchoate before Nuremberg and is very much established by the Nuremberg. What he also did in Nuremberg was personify one individual's efforts in an area of tremendous need, a time of tremendous struggle. He referred to Nuremberg as one of those things that he had to do because the president asked and wants to say yes to his president, but also because it was a time of great need. It was a moment like no other. There are few in a person's life, and many, many lives will never even have one, but sometimes a life will have a moment of desperate need, of a gap that one must step in to fill. And Jackson did that with all the talents, abilities, background, training that he had, and all the other good qualities. I'm writing about the man. I'm studying the man. He's no saint. He made mistakes. He's very human. He's deeply likable. But I think he demonstrated in Nuremberg was how human capacity can step up to try to deal with the biggest problems. You can't define a bigger problem than a world war that's killed over 50 million people. You can't define a bigger bad alternative than the proposal for executive action. You can't think of a more monstrous task than gathering three allied nations with yourself, four legal systems, a million pages of documents, 22 defendants, and making it all work as a real trial in less than 12 months. But he tried and he did. And he did it in a way that's just supremely decent, and that's what motivated his former colleagues to come, as I said, in a blank, to stand up and explain, describe, and speak in his memory. I'd like to close with some words from another of them. These guys call themselves Nurembergers, and they, over the years, had reunions. Jackson only lived until 1954, and in the years after his death, they had a number of Nuremberg reunions, and the reunion group, as one of them said, is shifting. The bigger group now meets elsewhere. But a dwindling number continues to get together, and we had a group of them here. One of the Nurembergers who was at the bigger reunion was a gentleman named Tom Lambert. He, after Nuremberg, became a distinguished law professor in Boston, Boston University, Boston College, Suffolk Law School. And he joined the bigger meeting a couple of years ago. But in 1995, he was at one of this planet's reunions at a panel discussion on the occasion of the 50th anniversary. And he answered a question about Jackson with these words, which I think captures the human part that I'm finishing on. So, Tom Lambert. We, the prosecution's legal staff at Nuremberg, had the good fortune to be in the hands of a great chief. You can always tell something about a law office when you walk into it. The quality of the man or the woman at the head of it diffuses, transmits, is reflected throughout the organization. If it is a place that is ridden with anxiety and fear, you can smell it. The same is true in Nuremberg. We had the good fortune to be in the hands of a man of high vision and low visibility, not high visibility and low vision. We had those in Nuremberg. How can you ever get an aggregation of that many people together without having gradations of poverty and nobility in their outlook? But the thing about Justice Jackson was that he was a master of both the microscope and the telescope. He had this vision of the trials. He wanted to substitute the force of law for the law of force in interstate relations. He wanted to establish that there were crimes against the peace, as well as others that we had in the books and in our codes and in our covenants. That was a non-delegable responsibility that he shouldered himself. What we got from Justice Jackson was the total view. The airplane's view, the bird's eye view of the case on the one hand, along with the worm's eye view on the other. Both were of prime importance, the bird's eye view and the worm's eye view. The little worms have a lot more to do with the richness of the acre that they cultivated than have the giant combines lumbering over the landscape of the farm. Here is elsewhere, God dwells in the details. And Justice Jackson well and truly knew this. He said, never prepare an opening for closing for cross-examination without bearing in mind what we're trying to do in this trial. Never attempt one of those things without making it an ice peg to break up the frozen sea within us. Because the opposite of love isn't hate. The opposite of love is apathy. It's indifference. Apathy will smother love faster than outright antagonism. And so we wanted all our efforts, our openings, our closings, our cross-examinations to be that ice pick, to break up the frozen sea within us and the indifference of the world. And I think he did. And I think they did. And I think that's a message that is extremely important to us today and will be forever. Thank you very much.